Thank you. Thank you, Chairman. And I'm very humbled to be able to present here in front of many heroes of mine. And if you have any question or criticism, please don't hesitate to contact me or talk to me. I think in my philosophy, I'm doing the research work not because I want to be the first one to doing them or be the best one. I want to be them to be most helpful and useful for humankind. Today, I will talk about some of the work we have been conducted at University of Texas at Arlington. My research was now mostly focused on medical application. Before I start, I'd like to give you some background how I get to this point. By training, my PhD thesis is in microwave, and my PhD advisor, Professor Radich, introduced me to microelectromechanical system, in short, MEMS, introduced me to use MEMS techniques for microwave application. MEMS, in short, is using solid-state device technology, fabrication technology, to make very small mechanical parts. And today, actually, we use quite a lot in our life. For example, every one of you in a car, you have one or more MEMS device that's in airbag sensor. And the Wii controller, your iPhone, your iPod, your iPad, they all have MEMS device, accelerometer or gyroscope. And the final dream of people work on MEMS is, how do we shrink the robot into micro-size so they can enter our body to repair our body? In my past work, I focus on using MEMS device for millimeter wave application. For example, we use MEMS devices to build actuator that can move micro structures, or use them for microwave switches, microwave capacitor, or reconfigurable antenna. Because they are so small, we can fit quite a lot of them on a single integrated circuit to increase the power efficiency and functionality. And of course, we have some fun. So in my lab, we built a micro cowboy stadium for Lilliputian. We actually built this cowboy stadium before the cowboy stadium was built. This is a scale 1 to 1 million. And in the middle of the field is a cowboy, you can see where a cowboy friends. Cowboy Hamlet actually is sitting on a thermal actuator. Just give you an idea of the size. 100 micron is about the diameter of your human hair. We also built something for UT Arlington. This is a Maverick Spirit. These are carved on silicon, fighting with fire ant. Fire ant is a big problem in Dallas. And we like to use this technology to address our medical application. So in my lab, we are focusing on that technology for medical application. I have two motivations to do this. Number one is the healthcare cost is keeping increasing. The red curve here shows for the past 15 years how the cost per person per year has gone up steadily. But I couldn't help but wonder if you look at your computer price, they keep going down, particularly like a hard drive. Computer hard drive cost, 15 years ago, it was $1,000 per gigabyte, but today is 10 cents per gigabyte. So I believe that engineering, providing mass production capability and some sort of network management capability can help to bring the healthcare cost down. And the second motivation I have is that I'm a professor. I have to worry about my students' future. And this is a survey according to IEEE in 2007. This shows the potential R&D job in the future. And biomedical engineering still remains to be number one. So as I train the young scientists and researcher, I have to think about their future. So in 2002, when I joined UT Arlington, it provided me a wonderful environment for me to switch from mostly military and telecom application for MEMS system to now in medical application. So in my lab, we combine multiple technology to address medical problem. For example, we use nanotechnology, in particular nanowire or nanoparticle, to functionalize the surface to achieve sensing capability. And we use MEMS technology to build miniature probe or sensor that can go into the body, particularly into small spaces like brain. We use optics for in vivo sensing or in vivo imaging, and we put a sensor on flexible substrate in order to be biocompatible for the tissue. Most of the sensors we build utilize wireless communication in order to transduce the signal from inside the body to outside world. And of course, all the medical implant has to be very small, so we design our own integrated circuit in order to pack as much as functionality into a single chip. At the same time, we have to also study biology. In my lab, we also study how cancer cells migrate on a microfluidic devices. And most of our device has to go through the animal model to be validated with their functionality and performance. And today I will mention three major technology platforms we implement for medical application. The first one is wireless neural devices. We are developing automatic pain recognition and inhibition system. This is for chronic pain management, but it can also be used for many neural disorders such as Parkinson's disease. We also expand the application into intraoperative monitoring for spine surgery. These are my collaborators' name. I work with a medical doctor at UT Arlington, Medical College of Georgia, and Scottish Rite Hospital for Children. And particularly, Dr. Pan and I has been working on the pain management issue for 5 years. The chronic pain is an issue globally, and just to be in the United States, many of us has chronic pain, and billions of dollars has been spent on the medical expenses. In the last resort, when Advil, Tylenol, aspirin, they don't work, the doctor will recommend to use a morphine pump. The implantable morphine pump inside the body, as you can understand, they run into risk of addiction and overdose, and also is not controllable by the patient. Neurostimulating, however, offer an attractive option, especially today. Spinal cord stimulation has been used clinically. The neurostimulator is a device deliver very small amount of current into neuron. Kind of like a modify or block the pain signal, so it never reach the brain, so you don't feel the pain. So the patient very often feel a sensation, like a tingling sensation, instead of the pain. And for the past 20 years, it has been proven clinically effective and safe, with very little side effect. However, today, even though clinically, it reports more than 50 to 80% pain reduction can be achieved, the system is really not optimized. Why do we need to optimize the pain? Pain is an indication of some illness and danger. For example, you put your hands on the hot stove. You want to be able to feel pain. Otherwise, you don't know when you should retrieve your hands. So we should really optimize the signal, optimize the system in order to distinguish the chronic pain and acute pain. And current system is open loop, so the patient has to constantly manually control, adjust the dose themselves. So we are trying to address a system that we can have a feedback mechanism to optimize the pain. But the question is, what is pain anyway? Pain is a subjective feeling. You go to the doctor, they ask you, give me a number 1 to 10. How do you feel? Many people say 5 or 8. What does that mean? The doctor or the patient themselves really don't have any means to optimize the stimulation dose. So our hypothesis is, can we quantify pan signal in order to use the signal in a feedback loop to optimize the simulation, like many of us do in the control theory in electrical engineering. So we propose a system that implements multiple neural sensors inside the body. They can be in the spinal cord or in the brain. They communicate by wireless. The device acquires neuron signal, transmits to a portable electronics like your iPhone or smartphone. In the smartphone or iPhone, you have a mechanism that can categorize, recognize, classify, and also find the best dose for the patient, then send wireless signal to the neurostimulator that's also implanted inside the body to deliver the current. And so this way, our mechanism form a closed loop between the body and the machine, continuously optimize the dose so the patient will constantly feeling less pain. In my lab, we have developed a wireless module, which is about the size of a dime that can be implanted. But today, because we don't have FDA approval, we only use the device for animal model. This is the experimental result. The blue curve here is indicating the signal neuron fired. These are from spinal cord WDR neuron. And each one of these is action potential that indicate a pain signal. By counting the frequency of this pain signal, then we can summarize with using this histogram to show that the pain level. The higher the bar, the more pain the animal experience. The green curve here is a neurostimulator implant signal in the brain. We put an implant in the deep brain area called PAG. And each one of this green square is actually 80 electrical pulses. And by applying a pain stimuli, such as a pinch, in the leg of the animal, and we will be able to coordinate the pain signal with the received signal. When there's no neurostimulation, you can see that the pain signal exists. However, whenever we start the neurostimulation, the pain signal now disappears. We also coordinate the animal's behavior with the data to validate that indeed the signal we receive is pain signal. We have done a statistical data analysis with 45 animal model, and we found by applying three different pain stimuli, brush is indicated as the no pain, and pressure and pinch indicate a higher pain. And we found that the blue bar and the green bar is before and after we turn on our system. The red bar is when we turn on our system for more than 10 minutes, and we found that our pain inhibition mechanism can reduce the pain by 25 to 30%. This system can actually be used for many different neural disorders. This is a list of approved, FDA-approved, or research under study neurostimulation condition. The black font indicates FDA-approved. The red is under research. And in our lab, particularly, we are working on using the feedback mechanism to reduce tremor for Parkinson's disease. This is a collaboration with Dr. Cole Giller. We use this for inhibit pain in brain or peripheral nerve system. We also use this to monitor the spinal cord injury surgery. Also, we use this technique to continuously manage gastroparesis and incontinence. Neurons communicate not just by electrical signal, they also communicate by chemical ways. They are called neurotransmitters, such as glutamate, dopamine, serotonin, and GABA. These chemicals, they are related to neural disorders such as depression and addiction. And what we are trying to do is not just coordinate the electrical signal, but also coordinate the chemical signal to understand the issue with all this neural disorder. So what we do is we implement the neurotransmitter electrode by functionalized with enzyme on our MEMS electrode. With one single electrode, we can have 5 or 7 or 11 electrodes simultaneously sense different neurotransmitter and coordinate them with neuronal action potential. We hope that we can find the fundamental issues between the neuron and neurotransmitter. This is showing the probe we built for animal experiments. They have all different sizes. The small one is for rodent, and the long one is for human or monkey. We can also build them on flexible substrate or rigid substrate. Flexible substrate allowed the brain tissue to move with our electrodes so they can be used for long-term implant. This curve shows the electrical signal coordinated with glutamate concentration in the brain. The second project I want to talk about is a batteryless implant. Many implants today use a battery. The battery has a limited lifetime. So after the battery is exhausted, you have to go back to the doctor, have a surgery, replace the device. So we are trying to address this issue by implement batteryless solution so that implant either is a sensor or a stimulator that can harvest the energy from outside the body and use the energy for sensing or treatment. This collaboration involves University of Mississippi Medical Center, UT Southwestern, University of Auckland and New Zealand, and also UT Arlington. In particular, Dr. Tan and I are working on gastroesophageal reflux disease, GERD. GERD is a disease when the stomach contact rush into the esophagus, and many of us has this problem. We call the heartburn. Often you go home, you take some antacid, and you're fine. But some people, they have chronic GERD problem. They run into the risk to develop esophageal cancer. Esophageal cancer is the fast-growing cancer in the developed country, and very often is not curable. So our problem is, how do we detect reflux? There are two types of reflux, acid reflux and non-acid reflux. Non-acid reflux is silent because you don't feel the heartburn, so the patient very often don't feel the pain. GERD has been indicated as the prime risk factor for esophageal cancer. So screening and take prevention surgery is necessary. However, there are more than 19 million people in the United States might have GERD, so the doctor cannot screen one by one using conventional approach. The conventional approach is insert from the nose a wire into the patient's esophagus. At the tip, there's a electrode that can sense the reflux. And then the doctor taped the wire on the face and sent the patient home, said for the next 48 hours or 96 hours, you drink, eat, sleep, and work regularly. And imagine that, that's almost impossible. You got a wire coming out from your nose. And not to mention that very often the doctor will put four wires in case that you accidentally yank them out. So it's very uncomfortable, so the patient altered their activity, then the result is not accurate anymore. So while we're thinking that, hey, today we have wireless device that you can watch movie on your wireless device, why can't we make this wireless? So we'll implement a wireless device, and also it's a batteryless. The device can be attached in the esophagus. Externally, the patient will wear an electronic device. They beam the inductive energy into the esophagus, and the implant will harvest the energy, use the energy to operate the sensor and send out the signal and log into the device. And 48 hours or 96 hours later, you take a